I'd like to welcome you all to our lecture today with Professor Peter Russell. And I'd like to begin first by acknowledging that the University of Alberta is located on Treaty 6 territory. It respects the history, languages, and cultures of the First Nations, Métis, and Inuit people of Canada, whose presence continues to enrich our institution. I am Pat Paradis, the Executive Director of the Centre for Constitutional Studies, and the Centre is an academic centre in the Faculty of Law, and it is really about all things constitutional. So we facilitate research on constitutionalism and constitutions. We connect leading Canadian and international scholars through the publication of our two journals, the Review of Constitutional Studies and our online journal, the Constitutional Forum, as well as through our conferences and symposia. We have our next conference is September on reconciliation. And we also are a provider of public legal education and where we attempt to bring the Constitution to you. Our observations are generally that most people don't know the first thing about their own Constitution, so we're doing our best to try to see if we can teach something about the Constitution through talks like this. And also we have a downtown charter series where professors and lecturers give lunch hour lectures on specific sections of the Constitution downtown. So it is in this spirit of public education that I'm very pleased to welcome all of you to today's presentation with our very well-known Professor Emeritus Peter Russell. And we invited Peter Russell, actually, it was about a year ago, Peter, that I asked you if you'd consider coming to Edmonton in January or February. And most people that I invite say, well, do you think you could make it like the summer or maybe the fall? And Peter said, oh, sure, no problem. And so I really appreciated your enthusiasm, despite the fact that it is January or February in Edmonton. And so we've invited Professor Russell to be part of our 150th anniversary of the Constitution series. So we have several different lectures this year. And if you would like to find out about them and aren't on our mailing list, we are circulating a list. So please do sign up. And so now I would like to present another well-known political scientist who will be known to many of you, and that is Professor Steve Patton. He has been very, very involved with the Center for Constitutional Studies over the years. He's been on our board. He has edited a number of books. He has been on our review editorial board, conference planning committees. I could go on. A very great friend of the center, and a well-respected political scientist here in Edmonton, to introduce our guest speaker.
Thank you. It's an honor to introduce Peter Russell. You know, often you say there are people that don't really need an introduction. It's unusual to be able to say that to an audience that includes political scientists, legal scholars, and people from the community. Peter Russell really needs no introduction to any of those audiences. He's somebody who's well known within his scholarly field of political science, within the legal community, and within the public. Just a couple of weeks ago, I opened my, I think it was a Saturday paper, and there was Peter sitting at his desk at home, contributing to an ongoing discussion about Supreme Court appointments in the United States. Dr. Russell is an alumnus of the University of Toronto and Oxford University, where he studied as a Rhodes Scholar. He taught in the Department of Political Science at the University of Toronto from 1958 until 1996, and is now a professor emeritus from the University of Toronto. Among his many accomplishments and honors, Dr. Russell is an officer of the Order of Canada and a recipient of a number of honorary degrees. Dr. Russell has published widely in the fields of constitutional, indigenous, and judicial politics. He is a past president of the Canadian Political Science Association and a pioneer in opening up the courts and the Constitution as a field of political science inquiry. He is author of several books, including Recognizing Aboriginal Title, The Mabo Case and Indigenous Resistance to English Settler Colonialism, Two Cheers for Minority Government, the evolution of parliamentary democracy in Canada, and Constitutional Odyssey, Can Canadians Become a Sovereign People, which was first published in 1992, when I was a doctoral student, and many of my peers and I were busy writing comprehensive exams and teaching our very first courses, and we turned to Constitutional Odyssey to organize our thoughts. Not only did it include all the insightful analysis that Dr. Russell has in all of his scholarly work, but it also presented the story of Canada's Constitutional Odyssey with incredible clarity and detail that allowed us to really get a grasp of where we had been and where we could be going. Dr. Russell has also contributed a lot to public policy and political life in Canada. He chaired the Research Advisory Committee for the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples. He served as Director of Research for the Macdonald Commission on the RCMP. And he has served as a member of the Federal Task Force on Comprehensive Land Claims. Today, Dr. Russell is going to be giving a talk that is based on a new book of his that will be coming out in June, entitled Canada's Odyssey, A Country Based on Incomplete Conquest. This book will be coming out in June 2017 from U of T Press, and there are flyers on many of the desks. And I'm very pleased to present to you Dr. Peter Russell.
Thank you very much for that kind invitation, Stephen, and for Patricia for following through and getting me out here in the wintertime, which I don't mind at all. I'm a four-season guy. And it's great to be here. I was talking to Patricia the last time I visited the center. It was just being formed, and two names that you might recognize, two of my lifelong friends that are no longer with us, David MacDonald and Bill Stevenson, were kind of working on organizing the center, and it's wonderful to come back, and though they're not here, to see the fruit of their early endeavor. Well, I am going to talk about my new book, which, by the way, the flyers say it'll be out in the summer. We're now looking at mid-April. And if you pick up a flyer, you'll see how to pre-order it and get a 25% discount. I hope what I say today is of interest to you. You might like to read the full argument in my book. I have to start really by explaining this odd subtitle. Constitutional Odyssey is kind of easy. Odyssey is a bit of my brand because I did a book called Canada's Odyssey. I did a book called Constitutional Odyssey. Is it up there now? It had a strange subtitle that really drove me to this book. It said, Can Canadians Become a Sovereign People? And my goodness, did my friends in English-speaking Canada ever wrinkle their brow and say, what the hell is he talking about? But the point is, my Aboriginal friends and my friends in French Canada says, well, that's a really important. Of course not. We are not part of a sovereign people, of which a majority can decide what we're going to do. We have our own peoplehood, our own nationhood within Canada, and that was not broadly recognized in 1992. And so in trying to explain to an English-speaking audience that subtitle, I go back to this one because I believe it's the incomplete conquest of the English-speaking pillar really account for the kind of country we are and explain, and I hope you'll follow me, explain the title of the earlier book. So another way of putting it is to understand Canada at 150, you have to go back to Canada at 250. And that's what I'm really going to do today. I'm told by my kids, this is the elevator talk, a version of my argument You go up. I need about 12 floors of an elevator. Basically, the argument is that Canada's best understood, that is, its distinctiveness among the countries of the world, is best captured by following the relationship between what I call its three foundational pillars: Aboriginal Canada, French Canada, and now I've got to really pause, and English-speaking Canada, because most people say, well, he's talking about English Canada and I'm not in it. Oh, yes, you are. If you're from the Philippines or you're from any other part of the world and you're into English-speaking Canada, chapter 13 of my book is really about how English Canada became multicultural. So my intention is to include all Canadians in the three pillars. English-speaking Canada is not just my folks who are British. It's all those who operate mainly in the English language in Canada and identify, many of them, just with Canada, without even a hyphen. Hence, they often have trouble understanding my argument. My argument is that it's the interaction, the dynamic of these three foundational pillars that has driven our history. And the dynamic comes from changes within each of them. None of the pillars stand still. The Aboriginal pillar does not stand still, nor does the French pillar, nor the English-speaking pillar. Their changes lead to clashes and sometimes consolidations of steps in our national development. You notice I use the word national. I have no qualms about thinking of Canada as a nation state in the UN. But I also recognize there are nations within Canada. And the main argument put forward is the big pillar, the English-speaking Canada, which very early became dominant politically and demographically, for a very long time, wanted to get rid of the other two. Not by nasty, brutal force, we're too nice for that, but mainly by policies of assimilation. Their aspiration was for a single English-speaking British North American nation, which they wrote right into our Constitution, the title of our Constitution 150 years ago. And through most of our country's history, the nations within, that's what I call French Canada and Aboriginal Canada, survived. They had extraordinary resilience and did not abandon their own sense of nationhood. And gradually, the big pillar, at least at the elite level, very gradually and very recently, came to give up the grand idea of being one sovereign people and began to embrace the idea of being not only multicultural, but what is much more challenging, a multinational country, and the only one like that in the world. That's the book. I'd make to stop there and take questions, but I don't think you want me to do that, Patricia. I'm going to now really talk about the first part of the book, up to Confederation, because I find that's where the foundations of my argument, as well as the foundations of the country, are located. I can't do the whole of the book. It goes right up to the last day of December in 2016. So Justin's in there just in time, and I have things to say about what that means for my incomplete conquest thesis. So I'm going to begin by saying a little bit about each of the pillars. I start in the book and my talk today with French Canada. You might say, well, why not Aboriginal Canada? They were here a lot earlier, and sure enough they were. But French Canada, French Canadians, were the first to call themselves, they were the first Canadians. They got the word from Aboriginal guides who use that word to point them to a destination. But they were the first to call themselves Canadians. And I'm going to talk about the incomplete conquest. Is there a gentleman on there that you recognize? Francois Gaston Levy? I can't see it. No? Pummy? I can't see. One more. There he is. Now, is that a household word? You all know him, don't you? Sure. You know Wolf and you know Montcalm. You know what this guy did? He won a huge battle on the plains of Abraham, right beside the plains where farmer Abraham grazed his cattle, in April, now wait for the date, 1760. 1760, he said. And he beat the hell out of the British. Murray, the British commander, took terrible losses and retreated into the citadel. And badly beaten, Gaston there had a big army, nearly 12,000, half of whom, roughly half, were French regulars, but the other half were Canadians. And they were, what were they fighting for? Their home and native land. That's what they were fighting for. And they won! And I have some audience to say, now, Professor Russell, with all due respect, we actually won. We mean English Canada. 6 months earlier, in 1759, in the fall of 59, sure, Wolfe beat Montcalm. Yeah, you all know that. But how many of you in your education got to meet this guy? And how many do you think in Quebec know this guy? Well, I can tell you just about everyone. And doesn't that starting to tell you a bit of a story? Now, we did win the third period. We won the first. I'm talking now as an English-speaking Canadian. They won the second, and they won it, hands down. And we won the third in September of 17. We got a bunch of soldiers arriving on the west end of Montreal. There they are, without firing a shot. Governor Vaudreuil capitulates, hands over New France to Great Britain. Why no fight? Well, because a brilliant Englishman, or Irishman really, an Irish-American, Sir William Johnson, negotiated with all the First Nations along the St. Lawrence as they were approaching Montreal from the west, their treaties of neutrality. And the French were counting on their Aboriginal allies to keep the British from coming in to Montreal. But they took Montreal while firing a shot. In the articles of capitulation, while the French soldiers and sailors and officers were told they had to get out of there and go home to France. As far as the habitants, the population were concerned, about 70,000 of them, they were invited to stay on their farms. They could have freedom of worship. You say, what? That's not a big thing, Russell. We got that. It was a huge thing in 1763. They could continue to be good Roman Catholics. They had to be loyal to George II, the British monarch, and George III was just coming on, but the British monarch, but they didn't have to serve in the British king's armies. So compare that so-called conquest, compare that with the conquest that the British carried out in Acadia just 5 years earlier, in 1755. As you may know, the British captured two forts on that isthmus, the Chepco Isthmus that joins now New Brunswick to Nova Scotia. They found Acadian farmers with muskets in with the French soldiers. And I think you know what they did. They said, all you guys and all your sons and your fathers, you don't go home to your farms. will tell your families, your women and children, you get across the border into the United, well, it wasn't the United States, into the 13 colonies, into Maine and New York, right pronto, away you go. And the women and children followed. And then just 3 years later, after the British captured Louisburg, they tried to round up with modest success all the Acadians farming in Cape Breton and some over on Prince Edward Island. And they put them on ships and sent them home. What you should see there, you see the huddled masses of Acadians as they're being kicked out of Canada. Now there's a complete conquest, right? That's complete, done, gone. Why the difference? This is just a few years before the capitulation in Montreal. Well, partly it's numbers. There are 11 to 12,000 altogether in Acadia, just different parts of Acadia. There were 70,000, roughly, Canadians. Britain was nearing the end. It hoped of a seven-year war. It had just landed several boatloads of settlers with Cornwallis in 1749 in Nova Scotia near Halifax. So it saw Nova Scotia as open for British settlement. New England colonists were interested in moving north to what we call Nova Scotia. There was a matter of prudence, really, in not pushing the issue further with the Canadians. If they would be loyal to the king, let them stay on their farms. And that was a crucial decision. After it was made, the British still for a while, with instructions to Murray, first governor of Quebec, said, we're going to try to make it, we'll make it, a British Protestant parliamentary country. It's very interesting how Murray and his successor, we got Murray there now, the first military commander, and his successor, Guy Carleton, they were subversive. Instead of following instructions from London, they figured out that as a pure matter of practicality, the smart thing to do was to govern with the support of the French Catholics. There were about 200 to 300 English merchants, mostly in Montreal with their families, and if they had representative democracy, which Nova Scotia was going to get, that would make a matter of about 300 or 400 people ruling over 70,000, because at that time, there's no way in God's green earth Roman Catholics could be elected to a parliament under the British flag. Murray began to see that the smart thing to do was to make a working relationship with the Canadians. He invited them to be his counsel. He connived with various people to keep the French civil law, the local customary law that governs land ownership, the seigneurial system, family relations, important stuff like that, keep it going, though he had no instruction or formal permission from London to do so, to really accommodate, we would say, the Canadians. And he made enormous enemies with the English party in Montreal, who finally really had him withdrawn and sacked. And out comes this guy. You got Guy Carleton there? No. Go back. There he is, sorry. He comes out in 1766 to take Murray's place. And he's got kind of instructions to sort of clean up the act there and get on to what the British had in mind. And he's a smart guy, too. He's Irish. I think this is important. Murray's Scotch. I think the people who've been imperialized by the English have a kind of nose and sensitivity to how to rule others. And Carlton, instead of cleaning up the act, he follows very much Murray's policies. And part of the cleverness of Murray and Carlton inherits this. Murray managed to get a new bishop of New France, or now it was called Quebec, a new bishop of Quebec appointed. And folks, you just got to think now, papism at this time is like communism was in the United States in the 1950s. God knows what's going to be in the 2017. But in the early 50s, communism was a terrible thing. Papism was something that British governments and people were appalled by. So how can you have a bishop appointed to a British colony? Well, they maneuvered that. I tell the story in my book. And the British actually said he's just the superintendent of Roman Catholics, the new bishop, Briand. They wouldn't put the name bishop on, but when he arrived in Quebec City, he was welcomed, a warm, wonderful welcome by his Roman Catholic parishioners. You can see that the British are kind of learning how to do something that no other European power had ever tried to do. That is, rule the conquered subjects, so-called, of another European power, of a rival European power. And they were kind of working it out on the fly. And Carleton was very aggressive politically, went back to London in 1770, and he really, with a lot of support among the top lawyers in London, started to push for a kind of constitutionalization of how the British were finding out New France, Quebec, could be ruled. And that leads to the Quebec Act of 1774, which Carleton had a lot to do in pushing forward. And it's the British were so much further into constitutional government than their European rivals that it was really important to put what policy into constitutional form. And that's what the Quebec Act did. Its most controversial provision was that not only did it recognize freedom of worship for Roman Catholic people, it allowed their priests and authorized the priests, Roman Catholic priests, to levy tithes, taxes, on their parishioners. This is an extraordinary concession, accommodation of the British to a highly Catholic culture. It allowed them, now specifically said, they could carry on their traditional civil law, not the Napoleonic Code. We don't have Napoleon yet. It's their local law on civil matters, so important to them, and they'd have the blessing of British criminal law, which was centuries ahead, well, at least a century ahead of French criminal law in its terms of its liberal values. It didn't push for parliamentary elected assemblies. The people who drafted it realized that that wouldn't work yet in what was now Quebec. It would have a governor in council type of government, but it was clear, not in the act, but in the politicians who defended the act, that French Catholics in Quebec could serve on that council. This Quebec Act is, I think, rightly seen by French Canadians as their Magna Carta, and so it was. It was an extraordinary accommodation with the culture and traditions and laws of the French Canadian people. And while it was welcome in French Canada, it had a different effect on America. Is that a map? Yeah. And maybe you can see from that map why. Because the boundaries of Quebec were extended way over to the end of the Great Lakes, and almost to the Mississippi and away down to the Ohio River. I know it's a very rough map, but what that means to the people of the 13 colonies, that part of British North America, now Quebec, is not open to them. It's closed to them. The majority of its people are Aboriginal, and that's acknowledged. The main interest of Britain is carrying on the fur trade, and it's closed to American expansion. And it was a red flag to a lot of Americans who were moving towards revolution. It was possibly also a, who have you got? Have you got there now? I can't see it. Is it the occupation of Montreal? It also has something to do with the one of the first moves the Continental Congress made after the revolution broke out in the fall of 75. They invaded Canada. It's the first of two invasions. They'll invade again in 1812. They put Quebec under siege, but they occupied Montreal for the better part of 8 months. A lot of Canadians don't know that. And their slogan, sort of drawn up in an interesting letter that Ben Franklin wrote for the Continental Congress, was, wait for it, "We'll conquer you into freedom." You've heard that one before, maybe. "We'll conquer you into freedom." And that was their game plan to make Quebec the 14th state. Well, what happened is they didn't pull it off at all. But it scared the hell out of Guy Carleton, who was now the governor, because he found, as the American army, and it's really army in quotation marks, they're mostly farm boys with muskets, and their November when they started up through Lake Champlain, the Richelieu River, and then started walk across the fields of the habitants. They were cold, they were hungry, they weren't really prepared for battle. And what did the habitants do as they saw them walking by their houses? They welcomed them in and warmed them up at the fire, gave them something to eat, and sent them on their way. But would they join? They were asked, "Would you join us?" No bloody way were they interested in joining a group of Protestant rebels from the 13 colonies. Carleton was very, very alarmed at their, what he called their friendly neutrality. But it was important that they were not at all any more interested in fighting for an American Republican cause than they were for fighting for the King of England. They stayed friendly neutrals. Now, I'm going to stop on the French there because I think you can see by this time, this conquest is really incomplete, and its incompleteness is surely very important to where this country's headed. Let me go to the other smaller pillar, Aboriginal Canada. And here, it's even less appropriate to talk about conquest and Britain's relations with Aboriginal peoples in what is now Canada than it was with the French. And what really happened when the French handed over all that territory, which was Indian territory, had been for centuries, to the British, the indigenous people who didn't hear about it for a few months, the Peace of Paris was in February 63, but by May of 63, a word of what was in that Peace of Paris had got into Aboriginal communication networks. And they were really not just pissed off, they were angry. I guess for two fundamental reasons. One is just the pure arrogance of one European power taking their land and handing it over to another. I didn't accept that for a moment. But a more practical concern is they had a very different image, conception of what it was like to coexist on the land and be on the land with British settlers, British Protestant settlers, in contrast to French that they were used to. There's a bit of, I know, romanticization of the French relationship with indigenous people in the 16th and 17th century, but it was, compared with the British, a more peaceful, congenial relationship. It was one in which its main architect, Champlain, really had the image of building a new civilization of French and Aboriginal, mostly French men taking Aboriginal wives. Whereas the British, when they came, not first to Virginia, but then even more strikingly to what is now New England, they came with loads of people wanting land and trying to get land, and they were looking for land, not brides, as I put it, and that scared the hell out of the Aboriginal people. They fought some tremendously vicious wars, King Philip's Wars in the 17th century in what is now New England. So they had a very negative impression of what it would be like to share country with the British. And they did something about it. Down in southwest part of my province, Ontario, a chief, an Odawa chief, Odawa, O-D-A-W-A, giving its coming on to be called Ottawas now, the Ottawa or Odawa chief Pontiac, now I'm going to get him there. Have I got him? He, with other leaders, many of them Potawatomi, who are Anishinaabeg, and some Wendat, who are Iroquoian-speaking, and many others, it turned out, another, I'd say 10 or 12, I've got them listed in my book, they formed a military alliance to make a stand against the British. It's called in the history books the Pontiac Uprising. And it was spurred on by a kind of prophet called Neil Lynn, you'll meet him in my book, who really was preaching in Aboriginal communities that this is our last chance to really stop the encroachment of European civilization on our lands. They have many positive things they gained from European contact, but a lot of negatives. Particularly what bothered Neil Lynn was the divergence of British settlers and soldiers on the land from what the missionaries, what the Bible said. They found there was a lack of moral consistency. And Neil Lynn was very, very effective. The Confederacy that Pontiac led took all the forts that France had handed over to Britain in the Northwest, half of them. It put Detroit and Niagara and Pitt, which is where Fort Pitt, where Pittsburgh is, under siege. And they sent raiding parties down the Ohio River. They killed families that had settled on their land. One historian compares the shock to Pearl Harbor. This was really tough stuff. The British had to make a decision. What are you going to do about this? And they had a choice of policies. Their commander-in-chief in North America was a British general, Geoffrey Amherst. He was commander-in-chief, and he said, well, we have to get more soldiers over here, and we'll have to fight the Aboriginal people. We have to conquer them. The other policy, and one reason that was a difficult policy to sell in England, the year is 1763. We're in the seventh year of it. We didn't know it was going to be a seven-year war, but Britain has spent a lot of money. And it's a parliamentary country, and it has to go to parliament to get money. And you can imagine the politicians not being thrilled about raising money for to add to the British armed forces in North America. So the other guy who pushes the winning policy, have I got Sir William there? What? Is William Johnson. In a way, he's a hero of my book. Young Irishman who came out in 1738 and to manage his uncle's lands along the Mohawk River. and he becomes very native in his understanding, his language, and his operation. He gets very involved in the fur trade. The most recent of his six biographies, White Savage, is a wonderful by Fintan O'Toole, the dramatic critic. I diverged for the Dublin Times. His title is White Savage. And Johnson really mastered sort of diplomatic techniques and protocols to have good relations with Aboriginal people, but he kept close ties to the ruling elites in New York. And he promoted a policy of peace. And it's just fundamental for our destiny that the British, I think largely for practical reasons, chose to follow Johnson. They brought Amherst back, and Johnson's policy proclaimed, and is written in, what have we got there now? Huh? Okay. That's just, he has two, if you're apt to Google, and I hope some of you do, Google Sir William Johnson. That's one of his houses on the Mohawk River. They're both beautifully restored. He carried on a very bicultural life there. His third wife was Molly Brandt, stepsister of Joseph Brandt, who turns out to be a leader of Loyalist Mohawks. And Johnson is just crucial, I believe, in having the Canada we have now. I call him in my book our first father of Confederation, and let me explain why. His advice was incorporated in London by the British into the proclamation, the Royal Proclamation of October the 7th, 1763. Look at section 25 of your Charter of Rights, and it's right there. Took a long time for that kind of recognition to get there. The rights and freedoms of Aboriginal people recognized in the Royal Proclamation take precedence over anything else in the Charter. The proclamation is a six-page document. Please click it on when you get home, or you even do it now. It's just six pages. The first five pages deal with how Britain will govern the colonies it took over from France and Spain, the Floridas, Grenada, Quebec, and lays out a government plan for how they'll be governed. The final page deals with Aboriginal people, and it's addressed to those Indian peoples and nations. I pause there to say nations because I had an ongoing dispute with Tom Flanagan, my good friend in Calgary, who thinks the Indians invented the word nations. The British were always calling them nations. And it's addressed to the Indian tribes and nations with whom we are connected. We don't rule. We're connected to them. We're connected to them. And it promises that there'll be no more encroachment by settlers, British settlers, on their lands unless the land is ceded through an appropriate treaty process. And that's a crucial kind of promise to Aboriginal people, but it's made in London, which is a long way away, right? It's thousands of miles from its target audience. Sir William Johnson has the smart idea of having it paddled around the Great Lakes in the fall of 63, and the winter of the winter of 1764, inviting Aboriginal people who want to make peace with the Crown to come to Niagara in the summer, and they do. 2,400 sachems, warriors, representatives of about 24 nations. There's quite a bit of writing about those the nations that were represented there. Meet with Johnson, and they have a lot of bilateral nation-to-nation There's a lot of scores to settle after, prisoners to exchange, and so on after all the fighting. And finally, Johnson gives the pitch for the proclamation of 1763, its recognition of the political independence of those nations and their ownership of their land. And those are the crucial points of agreement. And they consolidate their agreement, I hope I got it there, with a grand covenant chain. Is it the grand covenant chain? There are many pictures, there are many recreations of it. And the exchange of wampum belts, which are a traditional way of Aboriginal people in North America making peace with European powers. The idea being that the native people will be on one side of the river. Sometimes they show a canoe and the British in a ship on the other side, and they'll share a river. The two blue lines across there, recognizing their recognition of one another's independence, and they'll keep out of each other's affairs. So that's how the Treaty of Niagara is made. And it's, again, one of those things, it's like that fellow Levy that most of you have never recognized. Most non-Aboriginal Canadians have not even heard of the Treaty of Niagara. For Aboriginal people, it's absolutely basic. It's their first confederation. It's the terms on which they agree to share this country with the newcomers. And if you read the calls of Murray Sinclair's TRC, you'll see number 53, he wants a royal cop, a new proclamation, which will recognize not just the proclamation of 1763, but the Treaty of Niagara. The problem with the Treaty of Niagara, it was negotiated, Johnson being the guy he was, in using Aboriginal protocols and consummated in that way. It wasn't written down. And a lot of my tribe don't take anything seriously unless it's written down. And in addition, it had no legs. Johnson was there with a handful of people, some of his family. English-speaking Canada wasn't there. Aboriginal North America, Northwest America, was well represented, but most of our ancestors on the English-speaking side were not there. And so it's no wonder that it didn't turn out to be an agreement that for a long time was carefully followed. Now I'm going to take you, I'm running out of time here, to English Canada. What have we got there? The Loyalists. Some say they made English Canada. That's a gross exaggeration because before the American Revolution, as you may know, there was a big English-speaking community, mostly Irish, in Newfoundland, though Britain wouldn't recognize them as a colony for a long, long time. And Nova Scotia was developing as an English colony as of the mid-18th century. But what the Loyalists did, what the French, the American Revolution did, it inspired and led a lot of Americans to leave America. A number of them went to the West Indies. Quite a few went back to the UK. But of the 100,000 Loyalists who departed from the United States at the end of the American Revolutionary War in 1783, and for the next 6 years, of the 100,000 that left, 60,000, the largest group, came north. And the biggest part of them came to what we now know as Nova Scotia. But about 10 or 12,000 came up to Quebec. Remember, Quebec now is, then, is what is now Ontario and Quebec and a lot more land further west. So they came, and by coming even in sort of modest numbers, 10 or 12,000, they began to open up Central Canada to English migration in a big way. And within 30 years, the demographic ratios have changed dramatically from a majority of a huge Aboriginal majority to a huge English-speaking majority, particularly west of Quebec. I haven't time to say too much about the Loyalists, but I do want to dispel any idea they were all stuffy Tories. There were all kinds of people. A lot of them weren't British. Some were German, Hessian soldiers. And of course, there was a very large group of Afro-Americans, and there was a very large group, some 6,000 to 7,000 Aboriginal people, led not just by Brant, but by his cousin Desiderato, who settled in the Bay of Quinte. That was the turning point for my pillar, the English-speaking pillar, becoming dominant. And I just want to close off this section by saying they brought a lot more than numbers. What they really brought, the loyalists, big time, were parts of a common, shared civic culture, shared by the three pillars. The argument of my book is you can't hold together a country with such deep diversity as we have without there being a common set of ideals and institutions about how to settle differences and how to be governed. There has to be a shared civic culture. And you can see that beginning with the loyalists. I briefly sketch in three elements that they brought. One was parliamentary government. It had been brought into Nova Scotia a little earlier, but by 1791, they'd set up Upper and Lower Canada into two separate colonies with elected assemblies and with the full sort of structure, the structure of parliamentary government with its two houses of parliament and the crown. But it was flawed. It was a very flawed model because all the power was at the top in the hands of the governor representing the crown and an appointed executive and legislative council. The elected part was virtually powerless, and it really meant, and I make this point in the book, comparing parliamentary government in the 1790s and early 1800s in Canada with Britain, is that by this time in Britain, the House of Commons was the hub of government. That's where government policy was really led from and where laws were made. In Canada, Upper and Lower Canada, and in Nova Scotia for that matter, the elected house was the hub of opposition, the hub of opposition. You give people the right to elect representatives and then deny them any real power, you've created a monster. And in the case of Lower Canada, the assembly becomes a vehicle, really, for nationalism, French Canadian nationalism, to really get going. Most of the elected people in the assembly are French. They're professional people. They're lawyers. They're writers. Notaries. Some are doctors, and they're getting full of the spirit of nationalism that is brewing at this time in Europe. So that's really an incubator for French Canadian nationalism. So it's a flawed model, and it's flawed in the English-speaking colonies as well. But it's still a parliamentary system of government, which we're going to democratize over later on, and we never swerve from that basic structure of government, which concentrates power in the hands of those who have a majority in the legislature, rather than a separation of powers. That's number one. Number two, and I find people might think this is quite controversial today, in our common shared civil country is monarchy. Monarchy. Did you hear the word? Monarchy. Begins with an M. You can imagine for loyalists it was crucial, but it was also a good formula for an acceptable head of state to both the French and the Aboriginal people. The French had no problem swearing allegiance to a monarch, even though now it was one that was Protestant and not French. And they had less and less trouble as they watched the French Revolution decapitate not only the French royal family, but the Catholic Church, because it was a very Catholic population at this time. So they have no problem accepting a British monarch. Aboriginal people have a long tradition of accepting the British monarch, not as a ruler, but not as a political power, but as the head of a family, as a family relationship. And quite a lot of our colleagues recently have written about the family basis. So monarchies are a congenial institution for all three pillars. And the final one, and in a way it becomes the most important one, is constitutional government. The idea that those who govern do so according to established rules and practices that cannot be unilaterally changed by those in power at any time, even if those in power are very popular. Britain had evolved from Magna Carta on up to the Glorious Revolution of 1689, turning an absolute monarchy into a constitutional monarchy. Its only rivals in the world were kind of Iceland and the Netherlands. But it had become a real constitutional country, not a democratic country. It was constitutional well before it was democracy. And constitutionalism, this idea of limits on those who rule that are broadly understood and are independent, are not controlled by those who at any given time have power, was also a very congenial idea to Aboriginal people. They had a long tradition of constitutional government. The great law of peace, the law of the Haudenosaunee, the Iroquoian people, is well known. There's another one in my province. Among Anishinaabeg people, had a confederal structure with constitutional rules built into it. So, and for the French, it was a new thing. They certainly had no experience of constitutional government from France, but they loved the Quebec Act. They saw it as being a constitutional limit on whoever might govern them. So constitutionalism is the third ingredient of this common civil culture, which is basic for us. As the decades go on and as I write my book, I add elements to the shared culture, not the least of which are responsible government, which gives the lower house the real power, the elected house the real power in parliament, then federalism, and then I've lots to say in later chapters about human rights, mainly after World War II, not just mainly, only after World War II, do we begin to move towards universal human rights and things like charters. So we expand our shared civic culture. But the point I want to make to you, that in my mind is the glue that holds this very diverse country together. And it's good glue, it works. And it is what binds us together. One of the very last ingredients to come into it is the acceptance, first of multiculturalism, which comes in the 1960s and 70s. We had lots of multicultural factual developments. A lot of our early immigrants from Halifax, from Nova Scotia, on into all the 20th century were not British. But we were very British in our sense of national identity. As the English-speaking poor, were in a way more British than the British. We didn't celebrate the diversity that people from a non-British background add to us. We started to celebrate only in the 60s and 70s. My book has a lot to say about that. So becoming multicultural and then multinational, recognizing the nations within and their right to carry on and not be assimilated, I argue in the book, eventually we don't get there until very recent years. And I say in the book, when we get there, it's not even entirely accepted at the mass level. Let me just close with this paragraph because it's the concluding paragraph of my book. I said, unlike Odysseus, who is Homer's hero in his Odyssey, unlike Odysseus, our Canadian Odyssey does not have a clear final destination. Odysseus was going home. We don't have a clear destination. Indeed, what we have learned at this point in our Odyssey is that it is unwise to jump to conclusions, either constitutional conclusions or conclusions about one another. As a country or society, Canada might always be a work in progress. We make the best progress in living well together when we learn more about those we see as the other. Canadians, not in our pillar. Canadians are not supposed to think of themselves in grandiose ways. Make Canada great again. We're great with most Canadians. We're not supposed to think of that. But I do suggest, in closing the book and this talk, that what we have learned about living well together could be of value to all of humankind. Multinational, multicultural Canada might offer more useful guidance for what lies ahead for the peoples of the planet than the tidy model of the single nation sovereign state. Indeed, Canada might be more like a civilization than a nation state. As an example of how diverse peoples can live together in freedom and peace, this loose, never settled alliance of peoples called Canada could replace empire and nation state as the most attractive model in the 21st century. I'm an optimist. Thank you.
It'd be best if you actually went to the mic so that we could actually hear them, if that's at all possible.
it's interesting. Yes, yes, please. I think she wants like to go to the mic. Yeah, okay, and I'll repeat your question in case. Yeah.
Professor Russell, I was interested just at the end of your talk, you talked about the shared civic virtues.
I call it a civic culture.
Civic culture which may bind these disparate nations.
Give them an agreed upon set of values, institutions, and so on.
One of the ones you identified was constitutionalism.
Yes.
And I wondered, from the perspective of Indigenous Canada, how that value plays out in terms of their attachment to it, given what they might regard as an abandonment of the rules of the game, the forgotten treaty promises, forgetting the promises of the Treaty of Niagara, and conveniently ignoring the number of treaties. And so what can be the attachment to an idea of constitutionalism if the reality on the ground has been that constitutionalism hasn't seemed to
Well, they keep pushing us. Did everybody hear the question? Okay, I think so. The Aboriginal people sure have, I put it in a blunt way, I spoke at a gathering of the Mississaugas of New Credit last week, and it was, it's clear, they don't trust either the French pillar or the English-speaking pillar now. But they want us to keep our promises. They're very realistic, being under 4% of the population, they're not going to be able to respond to Neilan's preachings in the Pontiac Uprising and resist our encroachment. They have to be true to the Wampum Belt, which we share, our sharing country, they're very positive about that, and they want to do it on constitutional terms, and that means honoring our treaties, and where we don't have treaties, then finding a better process than we have now, when we have a sort of a very shoddy process for negotiating new treaties right now, better than none maybe, and getting a better treaty process for settling land and self-government arrangements. That's all in the Truth and Reconciliation calls. It's also in the UN Declaration, which the government signed on to and is one of the calls in the TRC. So they're being realistic. I wouldn't say optimistic, but how else are they going to do it? They rely on constitutionalism as a very small minority in a state, most of whose people know very, very, very little about them. And almost very few know what I've just, the little bit I've spoken about today is news to the majority of French and English-speaking Canadians. So we have a long way to go. As a teacher, you're bound to look at the schools as the basic road along which the English-speaking pillar and the French-speaking pillar should, French Canada should move in having a better capacity to keep our promises. We have to know what those promises were and why they were worthwhile. I mean, they weren't loud, they were decent promises. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yes.
Yes.
Is there something that you would suggest that we might do to bring the three nations and very carefully articulate together to at least better appreciate the one comes
through? That's a really good question. I'm so glad you asked it. No, there's not. And a large part of the argument of the second part of the book, and it's based on our experience of trying to, fix it. Let's fix it with a big constitutional breakthrough. Remember that? Remember those days? Remember Charlottetown? It's kind of embarrassing. I worked like my butt off for that. What we learned from that is this isn't the kind of relationship you fix like that. We're too diverse. The Aboriginal peoples are too diverse. The Inuit have moved far ahead of both Métis and First Nations in getting a large measure of what is, for them, self-government. It's public government in areas where they're the majority. So they're diverse, we're diverse. You don't want to try to fix it all at once. And that's a huge learning experience that I really value because I wanted to fix it. By God, did I. I worked my little old butt off, as did a lot of my colleagues. And I don't think we were wrong. I think by trying to fix it, we showed at least goodwill to those of particularly Quebec nationalists. We showed goodwill, and it may have softened their support for becoming an independent country. So I'm not saying we screwed things up horribly. We may... our very earnestness about trying to fix things, I can hear a bit of that in your question, sir, I think was well meant. But we learned you can't do it. We have to be more patient with ourselves. We have to learn to be more patient. And I think we're doing, won't say well, we're doing okay. Just okay. I don't know if that's much of an answer.
Branch off that, is if we don't try to continue to fix it, in your view, is there the possibility that we could lose one of these nations by the next celebration of 250 or 350?
Sure there is. You have to live. That's why I was such a fervent supporter of those fix-it projects. I was sure that would happen. And a lot of my colleagues who are a lot smarter than I said, no, it won't. And I remember the night of the 95 Quebec election, I was doing color commentary for actually a radio station in Toronto. And at 10 o'clock, the S side was ahead. And I was thinking to those colleagues who said it could never happen, my God, it's happening. And then as the clock ticked, 10:01, 10:02, you may remember, 10:06, the nose drew ahead by a nose. So I think we came damn close. And we could screw up. I mean, my crystal ball goes about a week ahead. I don't know about yours. We could really screw up. And for Aboriginal people, I think of the Mi'kmaq as a really dynamic people in Nova Scotia and the Haida in Haida Gwaii. You'd think that might be more viable, but I find when I visit those peoples, no interest in separating from Canada. They want to make a deal. Most of them are pretty strong Canadians.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you very much for the talk. I was wondering if you can speak more to the multicultural zone.
Yeah. Here's how I explain it, and I think I'm very speculative here, and I may not be right about it. I think the gradual accommodation of the nations within, and it was gradual, and for a long time we weren't there, particularly with Aboriginal First Nations, but learning how to accommodate that, and it would not make the country ungovernable or impossible, made us more open than any other New World country, like the U.S. or Australia, to the diversity of multiculturalism. It's hard to explain why we had been more open. And those are the two countries that in the book I compare ourselves with frequently that have moved somewhat along our trajectory, but not nearly as far. This celebration of diversity, I found in, it was like in Edmonton, but with the Syrian refugees, and I've written an article about this, the fight in Toronto was the rivalry of civil society groups to get their Syrian refugees. We've got ours, you haven't got yours. I mean, I'm making sort of fun of it, because both our building where I live, we have a Syrian family, and the college that I'm principal of, senior college, is a Syrian family. And we were falling over ourselves. I was proud of our country and proud of our neighbors and my colleagues, and raising money, a lot of money, and putting out a lot of volunteer time to welcome Syrian families. But there's no other country in the world where that occurred. And I don't think there's anything in our water. I think it's this accommodation which we couldn't make in the past, but we gradually did, and we learned to live with, that opened us up to this other kind of diversity. That's the best I can do. And it really did open up, because in, you see, my chapter 13 of my book is called The Second Quiet Revolution. The chapter before is the Quiet Revolution you all know about, when Quebec became secular and constitutionally militant and nationalist. The second, I say, was the change in English Canada from the end of World War II to the mid-60s. And I trace that in speeches of politicians, the laws and regulations, and the celebration of the people's celebration of diversity. And that just came. I always have to say, I know it's not right down to every living Canadian. I still encounter friends who are troubled by the diversity they meet on the streets of Toronto. But for every one who is, there's hundreds of others that just love it and enjoy it and celebrate it and see it as the Canadian way. And there's no other country that's celebrating, is proud of its diversity, even though we often fail to follow through as much as we should. We consider that a failure, most of us, when we don't follow through. So that's peculiarly Canadian. You know, Angela Merkel doesn't have that much going for her in Germany. That's us. And I think you got to go back to Canada 250 to begin to understand why we build up and eventually get to this position we're in, because we sure as hell didn't plan to go up.
Well, I think that's a really wonderful way to end this talk of yours, Peter. I have to thank you so much, because I think you've given us this extraordinarily lively description of our odyssey. And I think what's particularly interesting is to see how kind of messy it was, the incomplete conquests. You don't think about those, but that incompleteness really did set the stage for what, as you said in your description, where we are today. You've given us, I think, a real different understanding of how we are, who we are, and why we are so different, let's say, from our southern neighbors, for example. Anyway, I do really want to thank you for your very spirited and interesting presentation. I think very few people could do as interesting a job of giving us that historical lesson and giving us a sense of being proud of who we are. So thank you very, very much. Mm-hmm.